16. That's at the end of the road. As you know, we've been studying through the book of Corinthians all summer, starting back in June and going through July and August and now into September. And so, did anybody learn anything?
Yes.
Okay, hopefully you did. Okay, I know sometimes to work your way through a book is not as exciting as other things they could choose as sermon topics, right? You know, I could preach a sermon, 3 easy steps to be happy and rich. Yeah. If anybody knows how to do that, you let me know. Because I don't think there is 3 easy steps to be happy and rich. So the only thing I know is that we need to learn biblical knowledge. Right? So all summer long, we've been learning biblical knowledge, going word by word through the entire book of 1 Corinthians. And that's what we need. We need the Word of God to saturate our minds so that we might know how to live the Christian life. Right? So our theme verse, with my little clicker, I lost my clicker. Anyone know where my clicker went to? Okay. I need my clicker. Do you have it back there, Owen? What's that? Is that a piano?
Question mark.
You have it? Okay, so yeah, don't throw it. There you go, there's our theme verse. Somebody playing with my pointer? Oh, you might have to do the screen for me, okay? Can you do that? Yep, I'll cue you. Okay. Anyhow, here's our theme verse. Even when your clicker doesn't work. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And so we've been learning a lot about what those words mean and what built up to that point where Paul could make that statement. So today we're at, if you can give me my next screen here, Owen. Okay, we're at the conclusion here of conclusion of Corinthians with chapter 16. And so I'm calling this Life Together is Challenging but Better, because we've been looking at the challenges of life, right? It's tough to work together with a group of people because people are not perfect. And definitely is challenging. We've been learning that all through Corinthians. But I think we could see as we got through this whole book, we could see that this is true, right? Life is challenging when we have to work together with other people, but it's better than hiding in a closet by yourself, right? And so Paul has a lot to say about that, and he brings it all to a conclusion here in chapter 16. And so I'm going to begin reading in verse 1 and through the conclusion of the book. Okay? 1 Corinthians 16, beginning in verse 1. Now about the collection for God's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of every week, each one should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Then when I arrive, I will give letters of introduction to the men you approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem. If it seems advisable for me to go also, they will accompany me. After I go through Macedonia, I will come to you, for I will be going through Macedonia. Perhaps I will stay with you a while or even spend the winter so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend some time with you, if the Lord permits. But I will stay on at Ephesus until Pentecost, because a great door for effective work has opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. If Timothy comes, see to it that he has nothing to fear while he is with you, for he is carrying on the work of the Lord just as I am. No one, then, should refuse to accept him. Send him on his way in peace, so that he may return to me. I am expecting him along with the brothers. Now about our brother Apollos, I strongly urge him to go to you with the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has an opportunity. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be men of courage. Be strong. Do everything in love. You know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia, and they have devoted themselves to the service of the saints. I urge you, brothers, to submit to such as these and to everyone who joins in the work and labors at it. I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunus, and Achaeus arrived, because they have supplied what was lacking from you. For they refreshed my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. The churches in the province of Asia send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord, and so does the church that meets at their house. All the brothers here send you greetings. Greet one another with a holy kiss. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. If anyone does not love the Lord, a curse be on him. Come, O Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. My love to all of you in Christ Jesus. Amen. And so concludes the book of Corinthians. As you can see with these concluding words from this book, we could make some observations, right? That the Corinthians were obviously a group of people who learned to experience life together in spite of the challenges. Many of them had, in fact, knelt at the cross of Jesus to receive the great gift of God's grace and love, and then they turned in surrender, to surrender their lives and their lives of self-centeredness to embrace something very different. What Paul called the most excellent way of living out God's love among one another in spiritual unity in the family of God. Certainly, as a church, they had many problems, but they also had an all-powerful Holy Spirit living inside of them to overcome their problems. They had many imperfections, but they now had the perfect love of a beautiful Savior to transform their hearts, making them into a beautiful temple of holy spirituality. The faithful weren't sitting in recliners of religion, waiting to get themselves to heaven. They were running a great race, doing everything they could to win the lost to Christ, so that many people could receive the prize of eternal life. They died to sin and they died to self, so that they could begin walking in the resurrection life of Jesus in every area of life. They discovered in the church that life together is indeed challenging. But this challenging life as a member of God's family is much far better than anything else that the world might have to offer. So right here in chapter 16, Paul gives his final words to this group of people that we could describe really as spiritual children, but children who were growing up to become mighty men and women of mature, Christ-like love and unity in the family of God. Challenged, yes, but growing and becoming better also, yes. So out of this chapter, I came up with a list of just 8 practical applications, just quick things we're going to work through here. Applications of the Christian faith that I think Paul gives as his final words to these Corinthians, just to kind of sum things up and all the things that we've been talking about. So I'm going to give you these 8 things and then finish up, after I'm done with those, I'm going to finish up with a selected reading of certain verses from each of the 16 chapters of Corinthians. Kind of like a sports highlights of the century type of thing, right? I'm going to just pick out certain verses and I'm going to read through those as a way to finish up our entire study here. So, first of all, let me give you the first practical application of Christian faith. Okay, number one is to faithfully give your finances to the Lord's work. Right, we saw that in the first couple of verses, right? Paul said, now about the collection for God's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. So here's instructions for Christians in churches. On the first day of every week, each one should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income. Okay, the first day of every, how many weeks?
Every
week. Okay, so he's talking about faithful giving, right? And that's obviously something very important. What I understand from observing in the world of the church, when a person comes to the place where they're willing to faithfully give of their finances, That's kind of like the last step. It's like the last thing that's hard for a person to come to and to mature into is to faithfully give to the Lord's work. And so Paul encourages these Corinthians to make sure that that's a priority in their life, to faithfully give their finances to the Lord's work. Okay, the second thing, okay, is this, to spend time with your brothers and sisters. It's a very simple concept, right? If you look at verse 7, Paul talked about that. He says, I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend some time with you. Okay, Christianity is not something we do just for an hour or so on a Sunday morning, and then the rest of our lives is something else. The best way you can learn and grow in your Christian faith is simply to spend time with brothers and sisters in the faith. Live life with them, right? They should be your friends. They should be the people that you're hanging out with. But we have to spend time with our brothers and sisters. Very simple principle. Okay? Number 3 is expect opposition to the Lord's work. Oh, we love that, don't we? Have you ever tried to talk to somebody about Jesus? You know, hey, do you know Jesus? And then they didn't respond in a positive and welcoming way? Did that ever happen to anybody?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Right? So we can expect opposition to the Lord's work. Notice what Paul says. He said, talks about a great door for effective work has been opened to him, so there's always work to do for the sake of the gospel. But notice the last thing he says in verse 9 is, but there are many who oppose me. Let me let you know, if you endeavor to follow the Lord, to do the Lord's work, to share the gospel with people, there will be many who will oppose you. Many. But why do we do it? Because of the few who have an opportunity to come to faith in Christ. We willingly put up with the persecution, with the insults, with whatever, because people need to know the Lord. And so we can expect opposition to the Lord's work. Okay, number 4. We should encourage those who serve the Lord. Notice verses 10 and 11. It says, if Timothy comes, see to it that he has nothing to fear while he is with you. He is one of the servants of the Lord. For he is carrying on the work of the Lord, just as I am. Verse 11. No one then should refuse to accept him. Send him on his way in peace. And so every time that you are rubbing shoulders with somebody else who serves the Lord, just try to make it a point to encourage them. Right? Typically what happens is we have a tendency to default on criticism, right? It's easy to find people's faults, isn't it? Right? It's very easy to criticize. It's always easy to point your finger and point out everything that's wrong with everyone and everything around us. It's easy to do that. It's harder to hold our tongue from criticism and instead use our words to encourage people around us. So when you come across other people who are serving the Lord, simply encourage them. Encourage those who serve the Lord. Okay, number 5 is kind of a strange thing. Okay, sort of a strange combination of words. Right? Be loving soldiers. Doesn't make sense, does it? Kind of doesn't quite go together. But notice where I get that from. Go to verses 13 and 14. And Paul has a lot of statements that sounds like he's talking in the perspective of a military exercise, right? Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be men of courage. Be strong. Sounds like a general speaking to his troops, right? And that's what we need right now is all those things are very important in our faith these days because faith is under attack. And so we do need to be like soldiers for the Lord, and we need to be on our guard. We need to stand firm in the faith. We need to be men of courage and women of courage and to be strong. But notice, the kind of soldiers that we are to be for the Lord is very different from the kind of soldiers we see portrayed in movies and things like that. Because Paul calls us to be loving soldiers. Notice the very next word, as he gets done talking about all those words that seem to have an application to a soldier, he says this in verse 14, do everything in love. So a worldly soldier might look at their task as, my job is to kill a bunch of people. I hate people, right? But as a soldier of the Lord, we're very different soldiers. So we have to be on our guard. We have to stand firm in the faith. We have to be men and women of courage. We have to be strong. But we do all those things with an attitude of Christ-like love. How easy is that? Anybody got a testimony? It's difficult, isn't it? But that's the calling of the Christian life, is to be loving soldiers. Okay, number six. Serving the Lord is a family affair. How many people here belong to a family? Everybody has to raise their hand. Okay? We all belong to a family. Why did God create family? It's the basic building unit of everything. Of life, of everything in the world, of the kingdom of God. Everything revolves around the foundation of the family, which is why the world is attacking the family so viciously in these days. What you have to see here is that Paul talks about the fact that serving the Lord is a family affair. It's not something we do on our own. It's always something we do with the family. Okay, you want to serve the Lord? Bring your family with you. You want to serve the Lord? Do it together as a family. It's something that we do, right? That's the basic building block of Christianity, is the family. Notice how he talks about that. Look at verse 15. He talks about households. You know that the household of Stephanus, not just Stephanus, but the household of Stephanus, in other words, his whole family, they were the first converts in Achaia, and they have devoted themselves to the service of the saints. They as a family, right? As Christians, we do everything together as a family. Our family should be serving the Lord, right? That's what they were doing. They devoted themselves to the service of the saints. I urge you, brothers, to submit to such as these and to everyone who joins in the work and labors at it. So we have to remember that serving the Lord is a family affair. We see another example of that in verse 19. Right? It talks about the churches in the province of Asia send you their greetings. But then notice this couple. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord, and so does the church that meets at their house. The church that meets at their house. You see, their family had become a basic building unit of a church. Right? Serving the Lord is a family affair. It's something we have to always incorporate as our family. Okay, number seven. Loving the Lord is our most essential purpose. Verse 22, boy, it's quite a verse, isn't it? Right? Look at what Paul says in verse 22. If anyone does not love the Lord, a curse be on him. Wow. Those are strong words, aren't they? A curse be on him. For what? For being a horrible sinner? We have to look at the words. Very important. If anyone does not love the Lord. You know, as I look around the landscape of America these days, I see a lot of people that kind of do like a shallow religion. Right? You know, oh, I go to church once in a while. I believe in God. You know, I have a religion. But here's the important question. Do you love the Lord? Do you love the Lord? You see, that's what it's all about. God didn't create a religion. He created a love relationship. He wants us to live with God in a love relationship and live with each other in a love relationship. It's all about the love relationship. Right? Remember we just learned in verse 14, do everything in love, right? So he says in verse 22, anyone who does not love the Lord, a curse be on him. Our goal, our life, everything of who we are and what we do should all be motivated from this place. Our love for the Lord. It's our most essential purpose. Everything that Paul talked about in the book of Corinthians was to bring those people to the place of simply walking in that love relationship with the Lord and then with others. And that's the very last thing that Paul talks about here, is the fact that loving our brothers and sisters is how we show our love for the Lord. Because it's easy to say, oh, I love the Lord. Okay? Show me. Show me. How do you show your love for the Lord? We show our love for the Lord by loving our brothers. brothers and sisters. That's how we show our love for the Lord. Right? Paul did it. His very last words in verse 24, right, I believe are absolutely sincere words from Paul. My love to all of you in Christ Jesus. Paul meant it. He was a man of love. A man of great truth. A great preacher of the gospel. Willing to do whatever it took for the sake of the gospel. But Paul was also a man of deep compassion and love for his brothers and sisters in Christ. He proved it because he gave himself to the Lord's work to the point where it didn't matter what happened to him. Paul was in jail for the sake of the gospel. That's how much he loved his brothers and sisters in Christ. That's how much he was willing to do for them. So loving our brothers and sisters in Christ is how we show our love for the Lord. Just like it says in verse 14, right? Do everything in love. That might be a good memory verse, right? Be a good bumper sticker, right? Do everything in love. A good brief description of how our lives should reflect the love of Christ. Okay, so I'm going to finish up this morning, okay, with these verses right here. All right? Now here's what I'm going to suggest to you, though. If you're really into Bible study, and you want to copy these all down, you want to follow, if you can follow fast, you can follow along with me. But I'm going to suggest you don't try to follow along, right? I'm going to suggest that you just listen. And I'm not going to read each reference, okay, because that would just kind of make it bumpy. I'm just going to read it as if it's one long thing here, okay? So this is the sports highlights of the book of Corinthians. This is what we've been learning about all summer long. And so I've just picked out these verses to kind of give us like a flyby, okay, of the book of Corinthians. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay, and then we'll be done. Lily's excited. Okay. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, and called to be holy, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. I appeal to you, brothers, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree with one another, so that there be no divisions among you, and that you may be perfectly united in mind and thought. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed it to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? The kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. Now I am writing you that you must not associate with anyone who calls himself a brother, but is sexually immoral or greedy or an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or a swindler. With such a man, do not even eat. Do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And that is what some of you were. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. I would like you to be free from concern. An unmarried man is concerned about the Lord's affairs, how he can please the Lord. But a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife. And his interests are divided. An unmarried woman or a virgin is concerned about the Lord's affairs. Her aim is to be devoted to the Lord may live a right way in undivided devotion to the Lord. Am I not free? Be careful, however, that the exercise of your freedom does not become a stumbling block to the weak. Though I am free, I belong to no man. And belong to no man, I make myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. Nobody should seek his own good, but the good of others. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Even as I try to please everybody in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. For I have received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts. And though all of its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. And now I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Follow the way of love, and eagerly desire the spiritual gifts. Since you are eager to have spiritual gifts, try to excel in gifts that build up the church. What then shall we say, brothers? When you come together, everyone has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. All of these must be done for the strengthening of the church. Everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. And just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, so shall we bear the likeness of the man from heaven. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be men of courage. Be strong. Do everything in love. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. If anyone does not love the Lord, a curse be on him. Come, O Lord. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. My love to all of you, in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of your love. And we thank you, Father, for the gift of your word, so that we might learn about this awesome love that is described in the book of Corinthians. We thank you, Father, that we have had the opportunity to learn from this group of people who had many problems, who had many imperfections, but yet they were learning to follow this most excellent way of Christ-like love and unity in the body of Christ. Father, all of us need to learn and grow. We thank you that by the power of your Holy Spirit that Paul described to us so well in this book, by the power of that Holy Spirit, Father, we have the power within us to overcome our flesh, to overcome the sin, to overcome the things of this world, so that we might live a different kind of life, a life of holiness, a life of love for God, a life of love for our brothers and sisters, a life of service with our family to the work of the Lord. Father, I pray that with the knowledge that we have, of what we have learned from the people of Corinth, that we could overcome the same problems that they faced and live a victorious life. Father, I pray that we would press on to win the prize for which God has called us heavenward. Help us to live up to the fullness of everything you call us to, that we might be bright and shining lights for the sake of the gospel, that just like the Apostle Paul, we might do everything in our power to win as many as possible to faith in Christ. Father, do that good work in us as we continue to learn and grow and become more and more like Christ every day of our lives. We pray these things through the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we're going to sing a song in closing there, brother.
Yeah.